Pastor Justin Sherry here from Washington, D.C. We're going to be in the room with Pastor Justin for 10 years, and he's, you know, they're just a great couple, great family, growing family, hating what happens to you in Washington, D.C. So that's that, guys, in the service. Thank you for our amazing presence. We really love and appreciate you. God's just doing a great work, and great things out of God's doing on the food. Your guys are amazing. So God bless you. Well, today we are looking at honoring God in worship. And I'm going to share some thoughts with you just in regards to this. Worship is meant to be life-changing. If you look on the screen, you will see the core values of our church. And over the past few months, this is the only core value that we actually haven't addressed in our preaching services, is worship. So we are doing that today. And when things are core values, they're not just a sermon title that you touch base on in private worship. They actually are just that, part of the core of who you are and what you're about. Because as we look at this topic, worship is predominantly a matter of the heart. And it's your heart that God really wants most. In the kingdom, things are done from the inside out. They're done from the heart out. And worship is absolutely one of those things that is supposed to start from the heart. In fact, in the kingdom, I just love the verse of Proverbs chapter 4, verse 23, and it says, keep your heart with all diligence. Keep your heart with all diligence. That's a profound kind of exhortation, all diligence, for out of it spring the issues of life. We've talked about honoring people. We're in this series on honor today. We're talking about, again, honoring God through worship. We've talked about honoring all people, actually, as it tells us in Scripture. We've talked about the rewards that come with honoring people. But honor is only to transcend into worship when we are honoring God. Okay, I'll just repeat that. You know, we're to honor all people. And we are to do that well. And to the degree that we honor, I believe there is a reward that comes correspondingly with that. But honor is only to transcend into worship as we honor God. Well, some people say, you know what? I don't like worshiping or expressing worship unless I feel like it. Because if I don't feel like it, I feel like it's not genuine. And I want to be offended. Well, can I just tell you that's not biblical? It's not only biblical, it's not practical. If we live any area of our life, especially relationships, simply by how we feel, as someone that's worked with families and relationships for 25 years now, I can tell you, if you simply go by your feelings and your relationships, you will be bankrupt in those relationships. There's no difference in our relationship with God. We don't worship and we just feel like it. Really gives us a picture of this in Psalm 103, verse 1. He puts us into practice when he tells himself and exhorts his own soul. He says, bless the Lord, O my soul. There's this exhortation that he's giving himself. I will bless the Lord. I will honor God. I will worship regardless of how I feel. We can go this way when we make a choice. Just like for Jocelyn and I, we need to cultivate ongoing love in our relationship. It doesn't just go into cruise control and just be maintained. It's not like that. Nor is it like that in our relationships with God. We have to be intentional and we have to make choices. But often we make the choice, for an example, for those of you that are married, you make the choice to go on and set aside a date night. You might not even feel like going. It's been a long day. Maybe you're tired. There's so many things in your mind. But you know, when you follow through with that commitment, often the feelings follow. You get a chance to talk. You get a chance to spend time with someone. And momentum comes from that. Because you chose. So point number one I want to share with you today. It's actually just another point. I just called it point number one. I thought it would sound really good, but I'm going to share a few points. So this really isn't point number one. What is the first one that's on the screen? You and I were designed and created to be worshipers. You were created that way. I was created to be a worshiper. And therefore, we will worship something or someone. We will. Everyone all over the world. It's happening. Whether we realize it or not, the question is, what is the object of my worship today? It could be money, it could be a position at work, it could be how, you know, your reputation, it could even be family relationships. Some of these things can be good, but what is the object of our worship? We are worshiping. Something has our first place in our lives, our yes. It's interesting when Satan was tempting Jesus. I find this really quite fascinating. You'll be very familiar with this, I'm sure. It's interesting when Satan was tempting Jesus, and when he's giving him, he's presenting these different temptations before him, but when he put all the cards on the table, so to speak, he was putting everything on the line. He shows us the kingdoms of the world, and he says, all of these things are mine, and I'll give them to whoever I want. He says, if you will bow down and worship me right now, I'll give you all of this. That before verse 8:10. Again, the devil took him up on an exceedingly high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory. And he said to him, all these things I will give you if you will fall down and worship me. And I believe these words that Jesus spoke can absolutely be applied to each one of us. He says, away with you, Satan, for it is written, this is the part, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve. You know, we all have responsibilities, we have jobs. We have hobbies that we enjoy. Most of us have a hobby that you enjoy at some time. It could be gardening, it could be the outdoors, it could be a vehicle, it could be like working on a vehicle. There's nothing wrong with all those things, but what has the first place of affection in your life? Heaven is a place of loud and exuberant worship. I love a quote by Reinhard Bonnke. A man, for those of you who don't know Reinhard Bonnke, he actually is one of the men of God who is not long ago passed away. He served the Lord many, many years faithfully. He grew up in a very small, very legalistic, kind of charismatic church, but it was Pentecostal. It was very small, very legalistic in a lot of ways. And his dad was a pastor. He really had very few opportunities to minister actually in that church. And God was giving him visions that he would be an actor one day, preaching to millions. And he's in this small setting, in a small little town in Germany, and really God wants to place visions in your heart that are way beyond your wildest dreams. And lo and behold, the events played out was right here in Rocky. Walking by, they end up in Africa. There isn't a single person, there isn't a single person that has ever lived that has won more people in Christ from New Testament times to today. Millions and millions of people, tens of millions in the nation of Nigeria alone, people that have been brought into the kingdom. Many of the Nigerian folks that we know about coming here, their lives went down, and some of them have been deeply impacted by the ministry of Christ. The senior man who gave this statement, heaven is a place of loud and exuberant worship, and what is allowed in heaven should not be good on earth. God's perfect will is always done in heaven. And it is a place, as you read it, of incredible worship. The Bible talks about this like thunderous waves of the ocean crashing against the shore. The powerful, that's what worship is like heaven. And Jesus told us, as we were to pray, that just like God's will is always done in heaven, the Lord's prayer, he says, we were to pray that same will that's always done will be done on earth. Even the elders in Revelation 4, verse 9 through 11, even the elders in heaven, sometimes we get so respectable. If I might say that, we get so respectable that we forget to have part of worship, that we bow before the king. So this is a place, there's a lot that can be studied around this, but there are thrones before them that obviously God selected these elders. We don't know much about them. But they're surrounding the throne of heaven. Let's read about in verse 9 of Revelation chapter 4. Whenever the living creatures give glory and honor and thanks to him, to God, who sits on the throne, who lives forever and ever, the 24 elders fall down before him. Who sits on the throne and worships him, who lives forever and ever. They cast their crowns before the throne. saying, "You are worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power in all things, and by your will they exist and were created." Elders are handpicked. These are leaders if there ever was leaders, I suppose, examples if there ever was examples. And yet, when worship starts, they bow out before the throne. This is a picture, a clear, vivid picture of what is actually going on in heaven right now. And what is going on in heaven? I believe we're supposed to be believing what happened here on earth. 1 Corinthians 8, Paul speaking says this: "I desire therefore that men everywhere, lifting up holy hands, pray everywhere, lifting up holy hands without wrath or doubting." Some people say, "Well, I'm scared of kind of being emotional, over emotional. I don't like emotionalism." Well, as I've just had conversations with people over the years, I whoever someone knows them well, there are times when they express a lot of emotion in a very short period. And whether it's in a rider game or wherever it is, there's something that gets their, you know, mojo going where they're actually expressing a lot of emotion. And if there's anything that should require us to be willing to be emotionally engaged in worship, the Bible gives some specific examples of worship we're going to look at in a moment. But point number two that I want to share with you. Now, although true worship starts in the heart, and I understand your work is worship. Serving, you were here before the service, that's worship. You're doing it unto Him, it's worship. We're not negating any of that. And although true worship starts in the heart, it has to be expressed outwardly. Love that is not expressed is growing cold. If you have a relationship with someone that means something to you, you need to understand how to express love in that relationship. If you do not express it, it is growing cold. I remember, you know, it's kind of a more common kind of, it's really a sarcastic sort of joke that you hear from me today, but I remember hearing my dad say it one time, I didn't even hear it. My biological dad, this is when I was a teenager, and him and my mom were in a dispute. And he says, "Well, something about, you know, you love me," and he says, "Well, I said I love you about marrying, and if anything changes, I'll let you know." Well, yeah, that doesn't work. Love not expressed is growing cold, and it's true with our love for the Lord as well. Now again, worship can be started in the heart, but actually I have a lot to say about what worship can look like outwardly. And we're certainly not going to prescribe this, but I think it's important, if we're talking about the subject of worship, that we actually look at and look at the examples of worship. Some of the examples that are given of people worshiping, singing, clapping, dancing, lifting up our hands, bowing, shouting actually, playing an instrument. Throughout scripture, you see examples of this. Go on a little journey. Look in a concordance. It's so easy with electronic devices, especially if you have an electronic device of some kind. If not, most Bibles actually study Bible for sure. I'll have a concordance in fact. Look up some of these words that have been on the screen. And look up the references, and you will see these are examples of ways to worship. Multiple examples of scripture. So what happens when we worship? I just want to say, I don't always feel like worshiping. You see me up here, I have my hands raised, and of course, as I already said, none of us are doing those things outwardly for other people. And hopefully church isn't the place that we worship. It's okay if that's what it starts. In your own private time, to be in your car. As I'm worshiping, as we are worshiping, as we are lifting our hands, As we were responding to the Lord in worship, can I tell you one of the things that's happening? Spiritual strongholds are being broken. It is one of the most powerful demonstrations of spiritual warfare. Focusing on the enemy, we are worshiping. And as we worship, it is a powerful, powerful demonstration of spiritual warfare. Actually, one of the most powerful demonstrations of spiritual warfare. And we're going to talk a little bit about what happens when we worship here. And some of these are going to be up on the screen. Okay, number one, when we worship, it demonstrates humility. You want to see the grace of God in your life? You know, what happens when you're going to, somebody walks into a bank in somebody's house and they're holding you up? The police are wanting you to surrender. They say, you'll rip your hands in here, okay? It is a sign of surrender and humility when we lift our hands to the Lord. God says this, he gives you grace to the humble. It's actually repeated in two different books in the New Testament. God resists the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. We want to see the grace of God released in our lives. We need to humble ourselves. One of the ways that we can demonstrate humility before the Lord is worship, especially in a public place. Because you know what? It doesn't look on the outside. God chooses to use the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. He sent Jesus in a very humble sentence to confound what people thought was going to be, you know, a true leader. As we worship, we are doing battle in the spiritual realm. We're demonstrating humility. And when we demonstrate humility, the Bible is very clear. God gives grace to the humble. The enemy has no response when we humble ourselves. Are you in a situation where you feel like you're in a spiritual battle? That could be at your work, in your family. We've talked about the three H's, we're calling them just to help us remember them. Honor, humility, honesty. The enemy has no response when we humble ourselves. He himself fell because of pride. And when we understand what honor and humility look like in these situations, God puts his hands on us. And the enemy really has no response when we humble ourselves. Honor, humility, and honesty. Number two, what happens when we worship causes our love for the Lord. We've already said, you know, love not expressed is growing cold. Well, the flip side of that is true. When we express our love, just like in our human relationships, we appropriately in those relationships express our love. But when you're investing that, it means something to you and it will grow. It's the same in our relationship with God. It causes our love for the Lord to grow because we are choosing and giving him our yes. It's actually something that Satan wants. Because it's the one thing that God's given you that actually God wants. It's actually the only thing he doesn't possess. He's given it to you. He won't take it back. But he wants it. It's your choice. It's my choice. It's my yes. And one of the ways you can so powerfully demonstrate God as a human is in worship. Number three, when we worship, it is one of the most powerful examples of our children in our church family. Not just when they see their parents worshiping, although, let me just say this, parents. No mistakes as parents, okay? We talk about honor in the home. But one of the things that is perhaps one of the most powerful statements you can make to your kids is demonstrating how worthy you are a worshiper of God. Your kids, our kids, should see us, and not just our biological kids, our kids in the church. They should see people they look up to in the world. They should see people, and of course we're not doing that right now because of COVID and all the rest of it. But they should see, our kids should see us outward worshipers of God. It will say far more than 100 Bible stories. Yes, we need to read the Bible, so please do not give them. You know, our kids are learning the Bible right now. Okay, it's not the gospel that we're ministering to them. We teach our kids the Word of God. The Word of God is essential in our home. But all of that is an outward demonstration of humbling ourselves before the Lord. Can I tell you something? There's a disconnect. kids should see a disconnect for the best fumble with confusion. This church, I am asking God to make us an ongoing, increasing way of worshiping church family. It's one of our core values. And when our kids see that, then we being imprinted on them, they will not be able to resist the old. Is this all fake? Well, it's not the only demonstration of being genuine, but this certain one. They will realize that real men and real women, they worship. And you can demonstrate that without actually having biological children. You can have a deep impact on them, but you don't even realize that by young people, by being worshiped. Okay, number four, when you can pull us out of spiritual dryness and surgery. It can pull us out of spiritual dryness and surgery. Number five, something breaks off of us every time we take that next step and demonstrate worship outwardly. It might be the first time that you raise your hand. For those of you that have that practice, do you remember doing that for the first time? A lot of people do, actually. Something tangible about that. They say, no, first time I raise my hands. Felt a little odd. It's a little awkward. You're kind of half thinking this is going. Something breaks off. Take those steps. People describe when they dance for the first time. You can do that in your home. You can do that in church. Something breaks in your life. It's a very powerful spiritual statement. Number six, it releases joy. When we're worshipers, it releases joy. We're going to look at some scripture in a moment. Talks about that. Number seven, it releases the manifest presence of God when we are worshipers. Number eight, it will lift heaviness and help you see your circumstances more clearly. When we're going through a very difficult time, one of the last things we want to do is worship. It will lift heaviness and help you to see your circumstances more clearly if you will do worship. Worship is the way supernatural presence of God at any time in your day or your week. It is a highly spiritual act and encounter. We're going to look in Ephesians chapter 5. Let's look at some scripture here on this part of the message. It's a very interesting passage of scripture to me. We're going to start in verse 7. We're going to go through and read to verse 19. And sometimes it seems like we don't understand, it's hard to understand. Why are these words, because actually when the original scriptures, they didn't have verses side by side. People filled those chapters and verses in just to help us find things and things like that afterwards. Nothing wrong with them. They're just, so this is written as a letter. And so it's often important that we kind of look at what's on, around the context of verses. Verse 17 says this, therefore, do not be unwise, but understand what the will of the Lord is. Just that in itself is so powerful. Do not be unwise, but understand what the will of the Lord is. And then says this, do not be drunk with wine, which ruin your life, but be filled with the Spirit. What do those two things have in common? Any connection? Speaking to one another in psalms and hymns and scriptures, in your heart of the Lord. I want to make a couple of comments on this passage. These are not just random kind of thoughts that are, we know are inspired by the Holy Spirit that are written through the Apostle Paul or to the church in Ephesus. These are actually connected. Do not be unwise, but understand what the will of the Lord is. Isn't that interesting? Of Pentecost in Acts chapter 2. That the scripture, there was a lot of kind of comments being made as 120 people are baptized with the Holy Spirit in fire, speaking in other languages. And there's this rushing language, this demonstration of the Holy Spirit in power. There's a lot of comments being made, but it's interesting that the scripture is intentional about including this comment. It said, somebody said they're drunk. Actually, a number of people thought they were drunk. They looked drunk, actually. They looked like they were drunk with, intoxicated with alcohol. In fact, it was so prevalent that Peter, when he's addressing the crowd in Acts chapter 2, he clarifies what's happening. He says, you think these people are drunk? It's actually not true. They're not drunk. He said, this is what was prophesied that the Holy Spirit would report upon. That's why these two things are connected. Because alcohol is actually, and the buzz you get from alcohol, is actually a counterfeit of the buzz you get from continuously walking in the Spirit. Sometimes he wants you to get downright lost. Is that what you think in Acts chapter 2? And I'm watching you get drunk. It's quite effective. It is the time. It's usually the next day. Oof. What a mess. You grew up at home, and that was awesome. I've never seen beer bottles all over the place as you wake up in the morning, you know, half drunk. The beer bottles, you know, half empty. We were designed to experience Holy Spirit intoxication. That's how it says. Don't be drunk with wine. That'll ruin your life. But be filled with the Spirit. How are we filled with the Spirit? You know what? Often when God gives us an instruction, can I just share this with you? When God gives us an instruction in His Word, many times how to walk that instruction out is actually right in that context. Okay? So in this case, it's the truth. You know, don't be drunk with wine, which is dissipation, or will ruin your life. But be filled with the Spirit. How be filled with the Spirit? Listen here. Speaking to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in the heart of the Lord. When we are in worship, it is just a statement we made previously. It is the fastest way, anywhere, any place, anytime, throughout your day, throughout your week. How much more will we come together as a body of believers and we worship? It is the fastest way to experience the manifest presence of God, which is the Holy Spirit in your home, in your workplace. Your workplace? Is your workplace heavy? Is your workplace dark? Go ahead of time. Get permission to whatever you need to do. I've done this with people, actually. Gone with the spirit of lust and filth and immorality. Brokenness. It's just heavy in their workplace. Where we're going to be, we will go and actually go after hours and start worshiping God with you. You can do that in a home. Does your whole home feel heavy? It's just really very simple. Be a worshiper. It will start to transition. You can see it can feel like it all the time. Have worship music. It's so easy for us today. Have worship music playing. You don't have a phone, use CDs, record player, whatever. Coming back, you know, record players are coming back. Young people, we have a retro kind of record player in the house that we moved into there, and the people, all these young people, want to come up with stuff. I said, man, you got a different time to just solve up. Set that. One of our partners said that. Don't know us. Singing to one another in songs and hymns and spiritual songs can fill with the Spirit. Any one of us can experience this. Is a powerful, powerful story. Okay, one more on. I want to see you into action. We've looked at this passage before. It so ministered to me. I was getting so excited. I'm sure our guy even think about saying it a couple of times this week because I was preparing for the sermon. Acts chapter 16, verse. We're going to start actually a little bit earlier. And the verses on the screen are going to start in verse 25. I'm going to read a little bit earlier and go a little bit further than the ones here on the screen. Okay. So we're going to look at this, putting this into action. And the context of this is looked at in the past couple of months, a couple of times. But I actually believe this is a theme not just for our church. I believe this is actually a thing for the body of Christ in this upcoming season. When chaos is all around us, when oppression and injustice and a breakdown of so many things all around us, let's read this together. We're going to read in Acts chapter 16, verse 16. Paul and Silas are in prison. Now it happened, as we went into prayer, that a certain slave girl, possessed of the spirit of divination, met us, who brought up her master's much profit for fortune teller. Quick side note, do not ask someone to tell your fortune, read your, you know, palm, any of those kinds of things. They're not just hocus pocus fooling around. There is such a spirit of divination, and many people are naive. There's only two sources of the supernatural. Many people are naive. Unless someone is a born-again believer, believes in the Bible that I'm holding in my hand, the scriptures that we know, and is filled with the Spirit of God, do not ask them for advice, you know, to tell your fortune or, you know, hypnotize or any of those kinds of things. Just a side point. And if you have, we can give you instructions about how to pray through and break the attachment of the enemy that's attached to your life as a result of that. This young girl has a spirit of divination. She followed Paul and asked him, the group of them, and cried out, saying, "These men are servants of the Most High God who proclaim to us the way of salvation." And this he did for many days, but Paul, being greatly annoyed, turned and said to the Spirit, "I command in the name of Jesus Christ to come out of her." And he came out that very hour. But when her master saw that the prophet was gone, they seized Paul and Silas, dragged him into the marketplace to the authorities. They brought him to the magistrates and said, "These men being Jews exceedingly trouble our city, and they teach customs which are not lawful for us to be Romans, to receive or observe." Then the multitude rose up against them, and the magistrates tore off their clothes, publicly humiliating these guys, and commanded them to be beaten with rods. And they laid many stripes on them. They threw them into prison, commanded the jailer to keep them securely. Having received such a charge, he put them in the inner prison, fastened the chains in stocks. These guys have been publicly humiliated for doing the right thing and beaten with rods. Now it tells us later in the passage that actually had stripes as you can see that were probably oozing because the jailer ends up having an encounter. Because these guys have actually the problem, the enemy has it. This is all the water that's going on. Many of the attacks, and troubles that you're facing, even when it comes to people, it could be someone at work or could be your family member or whatever it is. Can I tell you, often there is a spiritual force behind that. We don't go around blaming the enemy, but clearly that's what's happening here. And when the enemy comes against you, and you humble yourself in worship, it's going back out of our mind. But these guys now have no longer been stripped of humility and beaten publicly, striped on their backs, to where the wounds are bruising and flowing. I don't think this was like a real switch. This was for the worst kind of criminals that they wanted to make a spectacle of. I believe these were like rods. And they came down on these guys' backs over and over again. The pain that they would have felt. And I've shared this before, but you know, when we have a serious kind of injury, often it's at night when you're trying to sleep, and actually that thing just begins to throb. I believe these guys, you know, there's no painkillers. They haven't even had an opportunity to clean these things. They're in a filthy, dirty inner dungeon of a Roman prison. Infection is probably already starting to set in, and their bodies are probably throbbing with pain. Let's see what your response is. What should our response be in these situations? But at midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God. Oh boy. I had that one. And the prisoners were listening to them. I want to say this. In the midst of your pain, you don't realize how many people are watching how you respond. These guys have just been beaten. And it makes you know how the prisoners are listening to them. Some of us are embarrassed. We're not putting on saying we need to prepare to worship in front of believers. These guys are worshiping God in front of believers. That's not publicly humiliated. They probably still don't have much like clothes on. Maybe they're stripped almost anything at this point.
The prisoners listened to them as they worshiped.
Suddenly, there was a great earthquake, so that the foundations of the prison were shaken, and immediately all the doors were opened, and everyone's chains were loose. What happens when we worship? In the worst kind of circumstances that these guys find themselves in, the manifest presence of God shows up. When you worship in the midst of bondage and pain that you're feeling this morning, the foundations of the thing, listen, the foundations of the thing that are holding you back and keeping you in bondage will be shaken. Not only that, when the presence of God hits, the anointing will be there to set other people free. Everybody in that prison was in there in justice. God's not going to open the prison doors for a bunch of murderers to get out. The whole system was corrupt. What do we do? Throw our hands up, become critical? No, we become worshipers. When we become worshipers, we carry the manifest presence of God. Not only will you be set free, the injustice and the bondage that the people around you are experiencing will be broken. And they'll be set free. If you will choose to worship in the midst of the most difficult circumstances, we will see the manifest presence of God. Let's continue reading there. And the keeper of the prison, awaking from sleep and seeing prison doors open, supposing the prisoners had fled, drew his sword and was about to kill himself. But Paul called out, "Do yourself no harm. We are all here." And he called for a light. That's the prison guard, captain of the prison. He called for a light, ran in, fell down trembling before Paul and Silas, brought them out and said, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" They said to him, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved, you and your household." Okay. Just a couple of comments as we're preparing to close. When we become worshipers in the midst of difficult circumstances, the manifest presence of God hits. Just like this jailer, it will awaken people out of their sleep. They will run to the light. And they'll want to be born again. Have you ever given your life to Jesus Christ? Whether you're in our service in person today, or you're listening and watching us online, worship starts in the heart. You might think, well, my heart is not in good shape right now. But God loves us in great. Yeah, if you don't